40% GEO. The service has availability in the region surrounding GEO. In plastics, only 40% can be used. Other sequences are present. But in this case, a G can be changed for a D. A D can be changed for a C or for a G. What it was? A C. No, this is U for a C. GT, GI, GT, this position plus 6, due to C. That disrupts the spelling, this AG of the spelling with U1, and you can find U1 interacting with this. If you construct the U1, that is, when you change the A to G, you get the spelling back and you get again return. But look here, there is no skipping, actually. This is the normal gene, inclusion. This is the mutant gene. So you get a neutral retention. The system treats this as an exon, big exon. If you restore complementarity, you get this neutral retention back to normal processing. And in this case, it's not an inhibitor binding there, like in the exon 3 of NF1, but it depends on the exonic sequences. You see, this is the mutation that we saw in NF1 exon 3, and this is the mutation that is in this channel, in this potassium channel. If I introduce this mutation in the potassium channel, I still get neutral retention. So it's not this mutation that causes skipping. It's the fact that it's near to the 4 genes, remember. In this case, it causes lack of recognition. And it's due to sequences inside the exon, because if I put just the NF1 sequences there, I still get neutral retention. But instead, if I put the sequence of the potassium channel, the original mutation, into the NF1 exon 3, I get exon skipping. So it's a sequence somewhere here that is the site, and that this 5' base site may not be recognized. And you say this polypurine here. There are many other sequences contributing to this, but this is one of them. Essentially, what is going on? So, the spliceosome sees this 3' splice site and probably looks for the 5' here or at some point, and you can have no definition of this one, total non-definition, and then this is not recognized as an exon, and the exon is skipped here. Or if recognized as an exon is included, or like in this case, there is an exon definition of some sort. The 3' splice site is included, is recognized, but this intron is not recognized and is left on. I think that these are other examples of critical splice sites. I will skip them and lead to the next talk. We have worked a lot on cystic fibrosis, and regarding the 3' splice site, we have found another at the splicing on exon 9 that was caused not by mutations in exon 9, but by variability in the 3' splice site. This 3' splice site has a sequence that is repeated. TG9, T9, or TG10, T7 is random. TG, you know, is a microsatellite that people use to map genes in the chromosome. So it's quite common. And in this case, it has landed here probably because the transposon hit sometime, because only primers have it. The mouse CFTR exon 9 is 100% included and have a normal 3' splice site. Now, we found a patient that have this configuration, TG13, T3, and this makes very poor recognition of the 3' splice site, and this poor recognition causes full-blown cystic fibrosis. Intermediate recognition, like this configuration, may cause non-classical cystic fibrosis. Another variation system give you a normal one. The reason for all this was that there is a protein called TDP43 that it was bound to the UG sequence, and interacting with other HRMBs, A1 and A2, inhibits the 3' splice site recognition. We work a lot on this protein that is very conserved from human to Drosophila, and it's an HRMP. And they recognize GU through these two phenylalanines, and it was an obscure splicing factor until in 2006. It was found to be the protein that accumulates in the inclusion of the brains of people with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis or frontotemporal dementia. And now, Emanuele will tell you that story. Okay. Thank you.
Professor Barral introduced to you, what we have been working for quite a long time now in the lab is this particular protein, TDP43, that we really discovered when we were looking for the transacting factors that were capable of affecting the recognition of CFTR exon 9. And really, talking about this protein, what I'm going to show you during this talk is the other side of the coin, as Professor Barral talks. So Professor Barral just told you that you have many mutations and how mutations in the RNA can affect the recruitment of transacting factors and therefore affect the recognition of this exon. What I'm going to show you really later on in the talk is how, when you change a single transacting factor, how many splicing events can change and how this could be connected with disease. So, at the time, of course, the only connection with disease between TDP43 and human disease was the cystic fibrosis. And totally unknown to us, in the same year, people who were working in the neurodegeneration field, they realized that when they started looking at inclusions that were formed in the brain of patients affected by frontotemporal lobe degeneration, they could really divide the patients into two classes. One class where the inclusions were mostly made by the tau protein, and these patients carried mutations in the MAPT gene. And another class, much bigger than the tau one, or at least as many, that had ubiquitinated aggregates for which they could not not actually name the protein that was responsible. And the answer to these questions really that changed our life completely in 2006. Because in 2006, these researchers from the US in Philadelphia, what they did was they managed to isolate the aggregate for which the composition was unknown. They immunized mice, obtained the antibodies against the protein that were found in the aggregates, and finally they managed to see what these antibodies were recognizing. And what they were recognizing, they didn't expect this at all, was CD43 self. So starting from 2006, the number of people who have been looking at how this protein can affect disease, and especially neurodegeneration, has dramatically increased. And you see that more or less all these publications before 2006 and from 2001 come from Professor Bernal's lab. Now, but the publications have reached the level of approximately more than 200 every year, and they continue increasing, just to give an idea of how important this protein has become. And of course, what is this protein? As Professor Bernal said, this protein is a classical HRMT protein. So HRMT proteins, this is an old biochemical classification whereby initially when researchers were looking at the proteins that were associated with RNA, all the proteins that could bind directly with RNA were called HRMT for heterogeneous ribonucleic proteins. And heterogeneous ribonucleic proteins are very important for the entire life cycle of an RNA. As soon as the mRNA is transcribed from the DNA to the pool 2, the mRNA is never actually left as a...